welcome to this special service in the life of Glendermott as we ordain and install new elders into the congregation. And it's a great joy for me as moderator of presbytery to come to lead and just to say it's my first time in the church that's been renovated, and it's looking absolutely beautiful and a great job, and we're thankful that we're in this space tonight. And primarily we're here, of course, to worship God and come together as his people. We want to read from God's word as we come to worship. And 1 Peter chapter 5, here Peter reminds us, "Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties upon him, because he cares for you. Be sober-minded and watchful. Your adversary the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after suffering a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen." We're going to stand together as we sing our opening praise, "Tell Me the Old, Old Story." Let us stand to praise God together.
Jesus and
As we continue in God's presence together, let's just take a little moment of silence to still our hearts, and we pray together. Let us pray. Lord, we come again to focus our hearts and our minds on you, a holy and a mighty God. As your word reminds us, simply be still and know that I am God. Lord, we thank you that you are the God who is high and lifted up and holy over all. Lord, we thank you for all that we receive from your hand every day. And Lord, for this time of year where we enjoy your creation and the longer day, and we see your hand in all things, and we're thankful, O God, for that. Lord, we thank you for your word, the scriptures that are able to make wise unto us the way of your salvation. Lord, we thank you that you're a God who comes to us as a needy people. Lord, we think of Elijah in the scriptures, and it wasn't through the wind or the fire or the earthquake that you revealed yourself to him, but Lord, it was through that still, small voice. And so we thank you, Lord, for the word that speaks into our very souls and points us in the way everlasting. For Lord, we confess that we are a needy people. Lord, we are sinners in thought, in word, and in deed. Indeed, all of us have come short of your glory. And we come again in confession of our sin. Lord, we come and know that as we confess our sin, that you, Lord Jesus, are faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord Jesus, we thank you that you came and you entered into this sinful world. And indeed, as we have sang, we remember that we are the sinners whom you have come to save. And Lord, we thank you for that old, old story of the cross of Calvary, that wonderful redemption, God's remedy for sin. And indeed, Lord, help us to ponder again the wonder and the love of God at Calvary. And Lord, again, we thank you that Christ was triumphant over death, that death could not hold him, but he rose, Lord, victorious from the grave. And Lord, we thank you that the Holy Spirit came on that day of Pentecost, and Lord, that church was born, as we read in the book of Acts. And Lord, still today we thank you that you're building up your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And Lord, as you've told us from New Testament days, as various meeting houses and places were set up, O God, and gatherings, that they were to ordain elders. And we thank you that continues today to strengthen and bless your church. We acknowledge Christ, you, the head of your church. And we just humble ourselves as underlings, as servants, as slaves, Lord, as it were, when we consider all that Christ has done on our behalf. And so we thank you for this special night in the lives of the two Davids and Raymond and Stephen and Fiona and Samuel and their friends and their family and all of us that are here, that Lord, we might just be taken up afresh with you, and that you're the God who calls us to serve your kingdom purposes. And what a wonderful calling you put upon us to come in the service of Christ. So, Lord, just come as we think of the psalm, search us and try us and see where we stand before you. And, Lord, do lead us in the way everlasting. And, Lord, we thank you that you are the eternal God of grace that we come to and we rest in again this evening are. And not just this evening, but as these dear folks go forward in their service and all of us together, we pray that you will bless the fellowship of your people, particularly here in Glendermott. And to Jesus, we will give the praise, the honour and the glory. Amen. Amen. Well, just now, there's a scriptural warrant that's going to be read by Reverend Philip Houston. And Philip's the minister down in Ballykelly Presbyterian Church. And then just straight after that, Reverend Lindsay Blair, the minister of Falcon Vale, will come and read scripture from Matthew 22 and 1 Peter. Thank you.
There is only one church of God in the world and in heaven. This church is holy, Catholic and apostolic. It's holy by the holiness of Christ, the sole King and head of the church. It is Catholic, meaning universal, for the gospel message of salvation is for all nations. It's apostolic, for the truths preached by the church are the truths set out in the apostolic message of the Holy Scriptures. The Presbyterian Church in Ireland, as a witness for Christ, is a part of the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. The day of Pentecost may be considered the birth date of the Christian Church, yet in truth the history of the Church begins with the Old Testament, traced back through Israel to godly people such as Abraham, Moses, Samuel, and Isaiah, who by God's grace had faith in him. Ancient societies were often governed by elders, and the first record of elders in the scriptures occurs in the time of Moses, who was told by Jethro, his father-in-law, to choose out 70 men to assist him in the governing of the nation. In the New Testament, this form of government was continued. Paul, for example, tells Titus to ordain elders in every town where a local church was located. In fact, the New Testament asserts that the highest office in the Christian church is that of elder. There are several lists in the New Testament that set out clearly the qualities and graces necessary for elders. The words of Paul that everything be done decently and in order has been a basic guiding principle in all church matters. Throughout the history of the Christian church, three basic forms of church government have developed. They are congregationalism, that is government by the local church, Episcopalianism, that is government by bishops. The Greek word for bishops is episkopos, meaning overseer, and Presbyterianism, that is government by elders. The Greek word for elder is presbyteros, hence the name Presbyterian. The Presbyterian Church is a worldwide denomination that traces its modern roots to John Calvin, the Swiss reformer in the 16th century. In this form of church government, rule is exercised by elders. There are two types of elder, the ruling elder and the teaching elder. The teaching elder is usually known as the minister. The teaching elder, who is also called preacher, evangelist, teacher, pastor, or minister, in addition to the oversight of the church, which he exercises in conjunction with the ruling elders, is commissioned to preach God's word, to administer the sacraments of the gospel, and to instruct the people and to set for the defense of the gospel. Presbyterians hold that the office of bishop and elder are one and the same. The elder is the episkopos and the presbyteros, and the two highlight different functions. Our Presbyterian system of government we believe to be founded on and agreeable to the Word of God. In the Presbyterian Church, every elder is equal, and the minister as moderator is first among equals. So in conclusion, the Presbyterian form of church government, government by elders, means the following: assured leadership, leadership by consensus, leadership chosen from among the people, the call of God to service, which is both subjective and objective, and the call of God to serve him for his glory.
We have two Bible readings this evening. The first one is to be found in Matthew chapter 22, and then we will follow that with a reading from 1 Peter chapter 5. But first of all, from Matthew 22, God's word for us. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question: "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." And then 1 Peter 5, verses 1 to 4. "To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who will also share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away." Amen. We pray God's blessing on his word.
Well, let us stand again as we praise God, and we're going to sing, Lord, the light of your love is shining. And then there'll be a few announcements from Stephen Hibbert, your minister here in Dender. Let's stand again as we praise God.
Will be very short this evening. I'm not used to doing announcements anymore. George's taking over from me, so I have no idea what I'm doing here. But you should be doing this, George. Good evening, folks. It's good to have you with us here in Glendermott this evening. Can I just echo the moderator's words of welcome as minister here of the congregation? It's good to have you all with us for this special night for our six elders elect, and of course for us as a congregation, as we look to the future and what God has in store for us. But just a couple of announcements as we move on. You will see on your pews, there's a little leaflet and a little envelope. I mentioned these to the congregation this morning. Traditionally, at all presbytery services of installation and ordination of both elders and of ministers, the offering on the evening goes to the Students' Bursary Fund. As I said this morning, having been on the receiving end of that, it is much appreciated and much needed for our students as they go through college. Many who give up jobs and sacrifice to go into ministry, to serve God in that way. And this is the means by which we survive our years in college. So can I just remind you, if you are a taxpayer, the little envelope is there for your use, that we can, not very often you get money back from the government in tax, but please fill it in and we can claim it back and gift aid from the government. It'd be good to do that, and keep the little leaflet. It tells you a little bit about the Students Bursary Fund and what it's about. My only other announcement is to invite you after the end of this service across to the hall. You can make your way out any of the doors and across to the hall where there are tea and refreshments being served afterwards. It'd be good to take time to chat with you all. It'd be good to meet with our six new elders, as they will be then. Your elders elect now, you'll be fully fledged elders by the time you get across for a cup of tea. So you can get grumpy over there then. don't mean that. But listen, folks, come across and spend time in friendship and fellowship with us over in the hall. It'll be good to see you over there. We are now going to come to the point of our offering. You'll see in the order of service, we're now going to have our offering for that Students' Bursary Fund, and the moderator will pray and dedicate that once the offering is received. So your offering will now be received.
These tithes and offerings, we return them to you. So often we feel like the little lad who came to Jesus with the loaves and the fish. We have so little to give, but what we give, we pray that you would take and bless for the furtherance of your kingdom. Lord, we pause to pray and remember those who are currently studying in Union College there, and we thank you for them. And we pray for those who teach and those that you are calling. And Lord, the fields are white on the harvest and the labourers are so few. And we pray that you would call others into the great work of your kingdom. And we pray your blessing on the college. In this week of our General Assembly, Lord, we commit our church and all within her to you. And Lord, we pray and thank you for all that you have given to us as we return these tithes and offerings to you, and pray sincerely in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the sole King and Head of the Church, who, having ascended to the right hand of the Father, has given gifts for the building up of the Church, which in his body we are meeting as a commission of the Presbytery of Derry and Donegal, to ordain and install David Allen, David Chambers, Raymond Dunlop, Stephen Neely, Fiona Walker, and Samuel Young as ruling elders to the congregation of Glendermott. As required by the law of the church, the clerk will now read the statement of the standards of the church, including the rule of faith, as stated in the Code, Chapter 1, Section 3, paragraphs 10 to 14. Thank you, Paul.
The Word of God, as set forth in the Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments, is the only infallible rule of faith and practice and the supreme standard of the Church. It is the privilege and the right and duty of every person to examine the Scriptures, and each individual is bound to submit to their authority. Having formed a definite conviction as to what the will of God is upon any subject, it is each person's duty to accept and to obey it. In exercising this God-given right of private judgment, individual Christians are not to set their reason above the Word of God or to refuse light from any quarter. Guided by the Holy Spirit, they are to use their reason to ascertain the divine will as revealed in Scripture, and are to refuse to subject conscience to any authority except that of the Word of God. In the words of the Westminster Confession, God alone is Lord of the conscience, and has left it free from the doctrines and commandments of men which are in anything contrary to his word, or beside it in matters of faith or worship. The Presbyterian Church in Ireland, as a witness for Christ, has adopted subordinate standards. In these are found what the Church understands the Word of God to teach on certain important points of doctrine and worship. These subordinate standards are a testimony for truth against error and serve as a bond of union for members of the Church. The Confession of Faith, as approved by the Church of Scotland in her Act of 1647, and the larger and shorter catechisms prepared by the Westminster Assembly of Divines, are the subordinate standards of the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. Accepting these subordinate standards, the Church holds that civil rulers must be obedient to Christ in their own area of authority, yet they ought not to attempt in any way to constrain any person's religious beliefs or intrude upon their rights of conscience. The Church alone has the right to interpret and to explain her standards under the guidance of the Spirit of God.
Well, now I ask the elders elect if you can stand just here, is that okay? And they'll just bring you along into the front perhaps, if that's okay, come on ahead. Thank you. And at this stage, we're going to ask some questions to the elders elect, and they're going to answer individually, and we'll go through the questions together. First question: so far as you know your own heart, our zeal for the glory of God, love to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Saviour, and desire for the salvation of souls and the upbuilding of the Church, your chief motives in entering upon the office of ruling elder to which you now have been called? They are. Thank you. Secondly, three questions on the rule of faith and the standards of the Church. Do you believe the Word of God as set forth in the Scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments to be the only infallible rule of faith and practice?
I do.
Thank you. Do you accept the Westminster Confession of Faith as described in the statement from the Code as read by the clerk to be founded on and agreeable to the Word of God? As such, do you acknowledge it as the confession of your faith? And do you accept the catechisms compiled by the Assembly of Divines at Westminster and received as the catechisms of this church?
I do.
Thank you. Are you resolved through God's grace firmly and constantly to adhere to the fundamental doctrines of the faith set forth in the said confession and catechism so long as you remain an elder of this church?
I am.
Thank you. Finally, a couple of questions on the discharge of your duties as ruling elders in this church. Do you believe the Presbyterian form of church government to be founded on and agreeable to the Word of God? And do you promise to adhere to and to support it and to yield submission in the Lord to the courts of this church? Do you pledge yourself as a member of Kirk Session to work together with the minister in the oversight and the government of this congregation for the upbuilding of God's people in spiritual fruitfulness and holy concord and for the extension of Christ's kingdom? Thank you. You've confessed your belief that the Word of God contained in the scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments is the only infallible rule of faith and practice. It is under that supreme standard which alone is final that this church holds its subordinate standards. This being understood, are you now prepared to subscribe in terms of the General Assembly's formula? I believe the Westminster Confession of Faith, as described in the Code, Chapter 1, paragraphs 12 to 14, to be founded on and agreeable to the Word of God. And as such, I subscribe it as the confession of my faith. Thank you. Now, the elders are going to come forward, elders-elect, and they're going to now sign the minute book of the Kirk Session, and they're going to sign we, David Allen, David Chambers, Raymond Dunlop, Stephen Neely, Fiona Walker, and Samuel Young declare that we believe the Confession of Faith compiled by the Assembly of Divines at Westminster, as described in the Code, Chapter 1, paragraphs 12 to 14, to be founded on and agreeable to the Word of God, and as such, we declare it to be the confession of our faith. So we'll invite you now to sign, please. Thank you. Well, that's you signed up now. And could I ask the congregation please to stand? I'm going to ask the now elders to kneel, please. And we're going to pray just for God's blessing. So just you kneel where you are, and we're going to ask the commission to come around as we lay hands, and really as we pray for God's blessing on the work in which the Lord has called you to. Let us pray. We beseech thee, Almighty God, to grant thy Holy Spirit unto us, the Presbytery of Derry, and to Donegal, and now to thy servants, David Chambers, David Allen, Raymond Dunlop, Stephen Neely, Fiona Walker, and Samuel Young, whom we now, by prayer and the laying on of hands, ordain and install to the oversight of Glendermott congregation. Bless them in their service for thee, O God, and help them to fulfill the ministry into which you are calling them. We pray through Christ, who lived and died for us, who rose again, and who now reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. I'm not sure if we're to sing that or say it. We've said it now. Okay. Well, we'll ask you to stand again. And on behalf of the Presbytery of Derry and Donegal, offer you the right hand of fellowship, and that you do know God's blessing as you go forward in your service of Christ here in Glendermott. God bless. Okay, well, we'll let you retire to your seats there, and we're all going to continue to praise God together, and we're going to sing the lovely praise to the Lord, I, the Lord of sea and sky. We'll continue to stand as we praise God again together.
Thank you.
David, Raymond, Stephen, Fiona, Sam. That's some list. It's a good job your faces are in front of me because I would forget. Like last Sunday night when you leave people out. Sorry, but it falls to me now to say a few words to you as new elders here in Glendermott. You've signed the line now. There's no escaping it. That's it. You're signed up now. But of course, I also want to say a few words to the congregation here in Glendermott specifically as you receive your new elders into the leadership of this congregation too. It's good for us to turn to God's word and have a few thoughts from that. But of course, my first words that I would want to say to all six of you is not there's no escape, but congratulations and welcome to Kirk Session. We are overjoyed that you have answered God's call to come on to Kirk Session with us. I know I've said it to all of you before, but I think it's worth saying here again, but the congregation here have put their faith in you to play a part in the leadership here in Glendermott. They have seen particular gifting and talents in each one of you. And having prayed and pondered all of that, they have elected you as ruling elders in Glendermott Presbyterian. And they have now, you have now been ordained and installed by the power of the Holy Spirit through the presbytery of Derry and Donegal to serve God as part of the Kirk Session here in Glendermott. So, as I say, on behalf of the Kirk Session, can I say we are absolutely delighted to have you on board. And I'm not accepting any resignations from anybody that's already on Kirk Session, just in case that thought's come through your mind. But we do look forward to your input as we lead God's people here into the future. And something always worth reminding, I will remind you, no doubt, at your first Kirk Session meeting. I always do, but Graham highlighted it earlier on. All elders are equal. Sorry, it was Philip who read it, wasn't it, in the charge? All elders are equal, and that is the case. From the moment you walk into Kirk Session, we value your opinion and your input. God has called you to this position, and so we look forward to working along with you as Kirk Session in the future. I remember chatting to a colleague when I was praying about and considering my call here to Glendermott. I'll tell you everything they had to say now. But one of the main things that has stuck in my mind about that conversation is this, that he said he had seen great potential in the congregation in Glendermott. And I think we can sense that now. The new building, now with you all as new elders joining Kirk Session, I think we can get a real sense of what he was getting at. I have absolutely no doubt there is great potential here for kingdom work. And I really do feel you're all going to play a big part in that. I think, as I said before, we stand on the precipice of something that God is going to do here. And it's great to be part of it. God has already been working here over the years. He still has work to do. But what an awesome privilege for all of us to be part of it too. I know there's always going to be some sense of trepidation at the task ahead, but I hope that you're as excited about being part of what God has in store for us here in the future as I am to be part of it with you. But as is right and proper, I want to turn to a few thoughts from God's word for a few minutes together now. You'll know what my few minutes is. It'll be as short as I can make it tonight, don't worry. We've been going through, for those not here tonight from Glendermott, as we say, it's good to have you with us, but we've been going through a series of teaching on Sunday mornings here in the Ten Commandments. Now, we haven't got very far through them as yet, but that's kind of, I'm sure if you listen to Lindsay reading one of our scripture readings, that's where I want to draw our thoughts to first this evening as I speak to you specifically as new elders. to say Lindsay read for us some of Jesus' own words as he was asked what the greatest commandment was. And of course, we're all familiar with Jesus' response. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And all the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Everything else hangs on those two. Naturally, those are words which are fundamental to all of us as believers and disciples of the Lord Jesus. But I think they're also great words of advice for those of us who have been called to serve God in this awesome task and responsibility of leadership within his church. As you step out into leadership, that first and greatest commandment has to be what comes first and foremost in your minds and in your lives. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. As leaders of Christ's church, we absolutely must know that transforming power of the gospel in our lives. If you desire this noble task, as Paul calls it, of being an under-shepherd, well, then you have to be in a right relationship with the chief shepherd first and foremost, don't you? I don't want to scare you off leadership, but you're all wise enough to know that it's not going to be easy sometimes. There will be differences of opinion sometimes. Yes, believe it or not, we don't always agree with each other in Kirk Session. Imagine that. But I'll get you around in my way of thinking eventually. But it's in places like that where the devil will be at work. And if he can disrupt the leadership, if he can unsettle the shepherds, then the sheep will be in chaos as well. And the devil absolutely loves that. And he'll sit back and watch it, rubbing his hands together, laughing at his success. But that's where Jesus' advice really matters. To lead his church effectively and efficiently, this is the number one priority to keep in mind all the time. God must always come first. And then when our relationship with God is in the right place, when we work hard at keeping that first and greatest commandment, to love him unconditionally, above all else, with all our hearts, our minds, and our souls, it keeps us in check in a sense, doesn't it? We talked about that this morning, that it was the commandments that kept the people right. Now, we all know the importance of committees and the likes to run our churches, and of course, biblically, the first qualification for a committee member is that they're spiritual people looking after the practical matters of the church. But this is a good bit different. Kirk Session are the spiritual oversights for the site for the lives and souls of the people God has placed in our care. And so our relationship with God must absolutely be in the right place. Now, I'm not saying anything new to any of you here, but this is where our personal devotional and prayer times need to be a consistent and a fundamental part of our day-to-day lives. I said the devil loves it when he gets a foothold into our lives and into our leadership and disrupts the whole thing, but he hates it when we keep God and his word close to us. I said it before, I'll say it again, I've no doubt God is working in this place. You only have to look around you. But you know and I know where God is working. So is the other boyo. So we must be on our guard. I trust you remember what we talked about in our first sermon on this very commandment. The main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing. And that is the bottom line, isn't it? The main thing must always be kept, the main thing. God must come first. Keep him close to you. Keep his word close to you. And when that's right, then, as Jesus says, everything else will flow from that, including the second commandment that Jesus gives us. It all comes so much easier. I remember saying to a congregation once that I love them all, but there were just some of them that made it a bit harder than others. But isn't that the call of the Christian, never mind the leader, to love our neighbour? And of course, our closest neighbours are those that are part of the flock that God has charged you with pastoring to. Love them, and they will love you back. Yes, some might make it a bit harder sometimes, but if we let God's love shine through, then we're on to a winner, as they say. That's the importance of what we looked at when we were looking at the role of elders back in January, as we sought to guide the congregation to think biblically about what we see the role of an elder as being, that of more like a shepherd or under-shepherd, as we've already said, rather than in a kind of governmental ruling role. It's not just a job, it's not just a position that you've been put into. You've been called to this role. And we don't rule because Christ's love simply compels us to love the unlovely. We love because he first loved us. If God could love such imperfect beings such as us, if God could love us, the unlovely, and call us to pastor his people, then we must love the people he has charged us with the oversight of, warts and all, as they say. So my advice to you as elders tonight is fairly straightforward. Keep that in mind. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Everything else hangs on those two commands, and everything else flows from those two commands. Keep him close and keep his word close. To use the words I have used, I think it was back in January when we talked about it, about the qualification for sports chaplains, it's fairly simple, isn't it? Love Jesus and love people. And as you lead this congregation, if you love Jesus and love his people, then you'll not go too far wrong. So now a few words to you, the congregation who have prayed about and elected these fine people as your new elders. Because you believe they're the people God led you to choose to be part of the leadership of this congregation. And that's simply the first thing and the most important thing that I want to remind you of. You may have listened to the sermons way back in January on the qualifications for eldership. You may have pondered what you heard. You will hopefully have prayed about it. You will sort of certainly have written names on the little sheets, the voting papers. But ultimately, God chose these people. Not you. God chose them. And that's really important to keep in mind, both for you and for them. I know it's something that sustains me in my ministry. Just like the eldership election, well, dare we say, almost three years ago, you went through an election here. You went through the process of calling me as your minister. But God chose me. God led me here. Why else would you come to Glendermott? Seriously. If we believe what we say, that God is sovereign, and it is him who has guided us to choose these folk for this noble task, then they are certainly worthy of the honor that Scripture calls us to give them. Double honor, Paul actually says, in his letter to Timothy. Elders are people who are called by God to serve as shepherds of the local congregation. They are the spiritual overseers in the church. And Paul says that elders who serve God and his people well should be esteemed and appreciated appropriately for their service. Your new elders have made promises to God to serve his church. Your new elders have made promises to God to serve his people to the best of their ability. And folks, they can't do any more than that. You might not agree with everything that the elders make decisions on, but you as a congregation, in a sense, being part of this evening, have promised to help them and to encourage them. Because that's what Scripture calls us to do. So it's simple then, isn't it? As that Nike advert has said for years, just do it. Encourage them. Support them. Because they'll need your support and encouragement. They'll need your help and prayers. And they want it. So support them, encourage them, and pray for them. We've already hinted at about the work of the devil in the local church. So your elders, both these new elders and your current ones, need your prayers and your support. That is the call of Scripture, to honor and to protect them with your prayers. Yes, elders are more vulnerable in the church because they're more visible. Satan gets to see them more readily. They've stuck their head above the parapet, as the saying goes. So they not only face the same temptations that all of us as believers do, but they also face increased opposition from Satan. Serving as an elder, shepherding the souls of those whom the chief shepherd gave his life for, is an incredibly demanding task. In every local church, there are sheep, and sadly, yes, there are some goats. And so the elders, the local church, need all the care, support, and direction that they can get. The elders need godly wisdom and patience and resilience and caring for those precious souls. And folks, you have a responsibility to uphold them in your prayers and to support them in their work. Our elders carry a heavy responsibility that cannot possibly be carried out apart from being equipped daily by God. So pray for them, encourage them, support them. And we consistently pray for them, I think we'll find that makes it much easier for all of us to do what we're called to do, to honor them, to protect them, and to submit to their leadership in the Lord. We are truly blessed as a fellowship to have a godly group of people who God has placed in the position of authority and oversight of this congregation, both in the existing eldership and in our new elders. I certainly thank God for the elders he has called to this mighty task of spiritual soul care of you, the good folk here in Glendermott. They serve you diligently and faithfully. They serve God diligently and faithfully. They love the Lord, and they do love you. So love them back. And can I encourage you to give thanks to God for our elders too? Because it is in our best interest as a body of Christ and as individuals to honor them, to protect them, and to honor God who has placed them there. And folks, may God be glorified as we seek to serve him here and build his kingdom in this little corner of his vineyard. Folks, together we have a mighty work to do here. God has been doing a mighty work in this place for centuries. What a privilege, what a joy, and what excitement it is to be part of that work and to continue that work well into the future. Let's pray together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your church. We thank you for this congregation you've placed here as a witness for you in this area, as we say, for centuries. Lord, we do realize the awesome task of carrying on that witness here in these days. Lord, we know the world and society we live in, it is a darker place. And Yes, the evil one certainly has a great foothold in the world. And Lord, we know too that he would just love to get his foothold in your fellowships. But Lord, we thank you for the people you've called here to oversee this church. Lord, we thank you for their service to you. And Lord, we look forward as these six new elders come on board with the Kirk session to lead this congregation into the future. And we do pray for your protection for them. Lord, we pray for the congregation too, that they would help them, support them, and encourage them in this mighty task. And Lord, we pray that their work would be rewarded, that we would see many souls saved, brought into this fellowship, where we can meet and worship and glorify you and draw others into that mighty saving relationship with you through the Lord Jesus. So bless us, Father, each we pray. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to close our service, this part of it anyway, with our last piece of praise on your little sheets and on the screens. That wonderful new hymn, Grace, by City of Light, one of my favourites, and of course one of the congregation's favourites here too. Your grace that leads this sinner home from death to life forever. And sings the song of righteousness by blood and not by merit. Let's stand and let's worship God together.
folks, we end with prayer. We want to give thanks now for the food, and then that means as you go over, you can go straight in and enjoy the good things that have been provided. Lord, we thank you for the good things that have been provided, and we pray that you will bless our further fellowship together. And now on to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. And indeed, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be your portion and our portion this day, and indeed forevermore, until you call or come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen.